Welcome to the Huma Gro Farmer podcast with your host, Larry Cooper. For today's episode of the Huma Gro Farmer podcast, we're following up on one of the products that was mentioned quite a bit on our two strawberry podcasts, Zap. To tell us more about this product, in the studio we have Lyndon Smith, President and CEO of Bio Huma Netics, which is a company that makes Huma Gro products. And on the phone, we have Barrett Smith, Eastern U.S. Sales Manager and Agronomist for Huma Gro. Lyndon is the son of one of the company's founders, Dr. Jordan Smith, and he's been working at BHN on and off since high school, becoming president in 1995. So he's very familiar with this product, as is Barrett, who has also been affiliated with the company for most of his young life. Lyndon, our products Zap and ProMax have a lot to do with soil biology, though they come at it from different directions. Start us off by talking a little bit about soil biology and why it is so important to crops.
Yeah, so interesting enough, years ago when I started in the industry, farmers were of the opinion, oh, if you tell me I've got bugs in my soil, I want to kill them all because they're all bad. And then it, you know, took a little while to say, okay, there's good bugs and there's bad bugs. We call microbes bugs, in the farmer vernacular. So it's just been interesting to see that evolution coming through the years and how that's progressed and how that's grown. So in those early years, everything was about killing all the bugs. There were some very harsh chemicals used and still in some areas used are fumigants, and they create an environment in the soil where all the microbes basically die and the soil becomes sterile. Most pathogenic organisms have an ability to do what they call sporulate. And when they sporulate, that means that they lay eggs. We'll just call them eggs for ease of understanding. And those eggs stay dormant until the right environment shows up again for them to sprout, and then they start to colonize and grow. And so unfortunately, through fumigation, some of the pathogenic organisms are better at sporulating than are the beneficial organisms. And so therefore, we end up with a challenge where after fumigation, the pathogenic organisms come back quicker than the beneficial organisms. So what are some ways in which we can attack that problem or solve that problem today, has been generated by products like Zap and ProMax to be able to help the Huma Gro farmer to be able to advance and take care of the environment at the same time taking care of his microbial challenges.
And I'll jump in that that's not a small thing. I read the other day that 90% of essential soil functions are related to the biology in the soil. So if you wipe out all the microbes in the soil, you're really damaging your potential crops in the future.
Absolutely. We talk a lot about today, we talk a lot about soil health, and that is specifically focused on the soil biome, if you will. It's the microbial activity in the soil. The beneficial microbial activity in the soil is now a measurement of soil health. And so with movements like the Soil Health Institute and other movements that are in the ag industry today, it's a fascinating, a very unique opportunity for us to be able to speak to this and to be able to really provide tools to the grower for soil health and for improving the environment in which they're in.
So sometimes the biology gets out of whack and the bad guys start doing bad things to the roots and to the plants. What are some things that knock things out of balance that make them come to the front where the farmer's going to say, I've got to kill the bugs?
Yeah, great question. We're doing that through many, many of our cultural practices. One that has been diminished in recent years is deep-till plowing. Most microbial activity is in the top foot of the soil. And when we were doing deep-till plowing, which we don't do much anymore, maybe in some outlying areas, we're turning all of those beneficial microbes down into the soil, the deep soil, and bringing up sterile soil from the bottom and putting that in the top foot of the soil. So it was actually having the reverse effect. So now we talk about no-till or low-till, and that has had a huge improvement in the microbial activity in the soil. However, there are other practices that still, anytime we're running machinery over the field, it's called compacting that happens. That destroys the microbial activity, the beneficial microbial activity in the soil, because they like aerobic environments. And so just to speak to that for a moment, there's a difference between two types of activity in the soil. You have the aerobic beneficial microbiology in the soil, which is the one we're really after, and they are oxygen-loving microbes. These are microbes that take in the oxygen and breathe out CO2, just like the plants breathe in CO2 and breathe out oxygen. And so these organisms were designed by nature to do what they're supposed to do, which is to take care of the aeration of the soil and to live in this aerobic environment. Well, if we're overwatering, we're creating a, or compacted, as I mentioned earlier. So overwatering is a second area that creates an imbalance in the soil where there's no air, there's no oxygen being able to get into the microbial community. And so they tend to turn away or to die. So there are some true aerobes. So let's just speak about different classes of microbes in the soil. You have your true aerobes, which are the ones who are oxygen loving, oxygen breathing. Then you have facultative, and these are microbes that oscillate between being aerobic and anaerobic. The other extreme is anaerobic. So you got aerobic and anaerobic. I probably didn't say that clearly, but in these facultative organisms, they switch based on their environment. So in a oxygen rich environment, they are aerobic. And then they switch to anaerobic in a oxygen poor. Anaerobes utilize sulfur in their system. And so the sulfur organisms, they put off things like sulfur dioxide. They put off, sulfuric acid. They create other imbalances in the soil that are toxic to roots. And so we don't want those facultative or true anaerobic microbes to proliferate in the soil. So again, we cause that anaerobic environment through tillage, deep tillage. We create that through compacting. We create that through overwatering. And then we also create it by the chemistries that we're applying. Many of the chemistries that we're applying, herbicides, insecticides, pesticides, fungicides, are also toxic to the beneficial aerobic microbes in the soil. And so when it hits the soil, it's killing those and allowing the negative microbes to sporulate and then come back with a vengeance. And so those are the kinds of things that create this disimbalance in the soil. Imbalance, not disimbalance.
Wouldn't another thing be monocropping? So, for example, if you're growing strawberries in a particular field year after year after year after year, strawberry pathogens are looking at that like, hey, we've got a McDonald's here. We can just come here and eat everything that we want. And that's going to attract and get an imbalance.
That is a very good point. When we're monocropping, there's a couple of considerations that need to be covered. One is that in monocropping, you create the same microbial activity in the soil, so you end up with a very narrow group of beneficial microbes because you don't have all the diversity of chemistries coming out of the roots. The root exudates, and so it becomes all those microbes that like to form around the roots. And then on the other hand, you have the pathogenic organisms that love to host in the trash or in the residue of that particular crop. So a good example in cotton, you have some pathogens that overwinter in the stalks and the roots of the crop that we just harvested, and then they come back with a vengeance in the spring. And then again, so you've got this lack of biodiversity, and you've got this overwintering of hosts, pathogenic organisms that can explode on you. A few pathogenic organisms, by the way, are very important in the soil environment. These are what break down the organic matter that's left, the residues that are left, and cause them to cause that breakdown of that organic matter into humus. And so a good example of that is a fusarium organism. A fusarium organism is very helpful in breaking down crop residues and in recycling that nutrient. But the problem is when it gets explosive numbers in the soil, then it becomes toxic to the roots in the next crop. And so it kills the next crop because it wants to eat that and digest it as well and turn it into humus. So a few organisms are good. Many of the same organism is bad. So this is, I think maybe that gives a good background of where we're at in the terms of the soil solution and the microbial activity within the soil. So anytime we're fumigating, we're destroying all of that. And again, these pathogenic organisms tend to come back quicker. So when we first look at it, we want to re-stimulate. If we're going to fumigate, we want to re-stimulate the beneficial organisms in an aerobic environment to be able to create the diversity of the aerobic microbes in the soil to be able to proliferate and do their thing. This is where a product such as Zap comes into play and is so beneficial. Zap has an ability to stimulate both the beneficial bacteria as well as fungi. There are precursors, catalysts, enzymes, biostimulants, all of that in Zap that really drive microbial activity into hyperdrive, if you will, and really charge those microbes into doing all that they're supposed to do. Most microbes that are coming into the soil solution after a fumigation are coming in from the air, and these are beneficial ones. They just need to have an environment where they can survive and live, and Zap gives us that kind of environment. The carbon-rich material that is in Zap helps those microbes to proliferate, to grow, and we see not only a jump in bacteria and fungi, but then we also see a dramatic increase in this soil microbial diversity. So we're getting all the chains of microbes. You've got those that eat hamburgers and those that eat, steak and those that eat the veggies, and all of the diversity of microbes come back into the soil when we apply a Zap material afterwards. A great example of that is whenever we have farmers who will, they will cut their ground on one end. They're going to level their ground for water retention, for water holding. They want to level their fields. Very wise move. But the problem they have is they're cutting their ground on one end and dragging all those beneficial microbes that are in that top foot of soil to other parts of the field, which leaves a very sterile top ground. And for years, that top ground doesn't become fertile, doesn't become healthy. It's a very sterile soil. And so with a product like Zap, we can go in there and really create that microbial activity, that microbial diversity that's needed to make for a fertile soil. And so soil health becomes very dramatically improved and increased with Zap. Let me just talk about one other aspect of that. There are many companies out there that are selling a microbial inoculum. And I'll just kind of tease a little bit. One aspect of that is you don't want to use an inoculum unless you use something like Zap to give it a sack lunch so that it can survive and proliferate. But just sharing with you another concept about the idea of inoculation, it's interesting. In 1 gram of soil, 1 teaspoon of soil, you have billions, with a B, billions of microbes. You have billions of bacteria, billions of fungi, billions of actinomycetes, billions of algae, billions of all the other higher life forms that create the whole soil health, soil microbial community, if you will. And so if we think or we believe that one little drop of an inoculum that even might have, you know, very high colony forming units in it onto that gram of soil is going to make a difference to the billions and billions that are there, I'll just tell you that the chances are that what happens is that all those wild microbes eat this microbe that's been raised in a pristine environment. They will consume him very quickly, and there will be an increase in microbial activity in the soil. But it may not be what that particular microbe was intended to be when it was applied. And so very rarely have we seen long-lasting, you know, beneficial effects from microbial inoculums, whereas on the other hand, a product like Zap creating the necessary environment for those microbes to proliferate and become diverse, that's really the benefit of long-term soil health and sustainability.
Isn't there also a benefit of having native biology in the soil? I mean, if just like, you know, if you're going to put some plants in, you want to put some plants in that are native to the environment. If you bring something in from Australia, it may or may not thrive there. I would think microorganisms would be the same thing, that if you're going to bring in something from the outside, it may or may not thrive.
Most microbial inoculums are raised in a very pristine laboratory type environment. And so, unfortunately, they don't have the robustness that our native biology has. And so rather than trying to inoculate, the better approach, in our opinion, is to feed the microbes that are already there the proper food, making sure that those that are facultative microbes are becoming aerobic and not anaerobic, and making sure that the aerobic microbes are proliferating and have that diversity, because then they will outcompete the pathogenic organisms. And so a positive aerobic environment with aerobes proliferating with all the diversity of the types and, you know, genus and species of those microbes, this is true farming. Farming really happens on the soil level. Mm-hmm. And that's where a farmer, if he realizes he's not farming the crop on top, he's really farming the microbial community in his soil, if he really understood what he was doing, that's what's generating his yield, his quality, and his soil, long-term soil health. Anyway, where I was going with that was that if you stimulate that microbial activity, the beneficial microbial activity, they will outcompete the negative, the anaerobic, the pathogenic organisms. And through competitive exclusion is something that's called in the community. Competitive exclusion, we are not allowing those pathogenic organisms to proliferate. We've created an environment that's positive only to the beneficials. We've created the full diversity, so we're out competing for the food and for the we're keeping the sulfur away, so we're not feeding those anaerobic pathogens, but we're really stimulating the beneficials.
So just so that people get the right idea, when they look at the label, they may see Zap has nitrogen and iron and manganese and zinc, but there's a whole lot more that goes into this product.
Absolutely. Right? This is a product that has well over 100 ingredients in it. I can't even remember the last time I counted, but I think it's, you know, somewhere between 125 to 150 different ingredients. A very complex product to produce. And yet at the same time, extremely powerful biostimulant. Right now we're starting to say biostimulant. I recognize that In some states, that's still not allowed to say, but I will just tell you.
But you said it anyway.
I said it anyway. The USDA is joining in this movement to be able to eke out a biostimulant definition and what that states. And these are true biostimulants. We sell them as nutrients because that's all we've been able to do up to this point. But truly, in the future, we hope to be able to say that if you want the very best biostimulant you can add to your soil, ZAP would be one of those very best ones.
So let me ask about application, because I want people to understand that this is not something that you put down just as a pre-plant. This is something that you can apply whenever it's needed throughout the season. So talk a little bit about application and rates and things like that.
Application of ZAP is kind of like we tease about voting, right? Vote early and vote often. We want to apply ZAP as early as a farmer. You know, our approach at Huma Gro is never to go in and try to change the cultural practices of the farmer. What our intent is to work with the farmer and piggyback on whatever he's already doing. So if he's willing, we'll apply the ZAP as quickly as we can, and we're happy to get it in. We always talk about applying ZAP as early in the season as possible. A pre-plant would be best. But then again, that microbial activity cycle in the soil is typically a 15-day cycle. So when you talk about this stimulation going on, and by the way, through our microcarbon technology, this is happening very quickly. We apply today, it's going to start to make a difference today. This is not slow release, control release. This is immediate action going on in the soil. And so we're changing the environment from the moment we're applying. And we're seeing that activity level go for 15 days. One of the things that I've loved to teach people about is that after that 15-day really ramp up in microbial activity, then it slowly tapers off over time. If we can apply again at that next 15-day cycle, we can begin to grow it even more. And so we just start riding these waves or creating these waves of microbial activity. And so our recommendation for ZAP in the ideal world would be to apply ZAP every 15 days through the growing season. Now, we always like to start with a heavier dose. So our typical heavy dose is recommended 1 gallon to 2 gallons per acre, or we're talking about 10 to 20 liters per hectare. So those are our recommended rates. We typically see in a row crop with a lower budget, we're lucky to get a half a gallon, but we're happy if we can get to that gallon. But then if we understand this microbial cycle, if we can, through the growing season, come back at any point in time and reintroduce a ZAP to stimulate that environment again with these all of these precursors of microbial activity, then we're going to start to create these waves of microbial activity that really will keep all the pathogens out through the growing season. So we like to start, for example, with a gallon per acre, 10 liters per hectare, and then maybe in 15 days come back if we have the opportunity. We recognize that there's some crops that we just don't have the budget for that. So we fully understand there's got to be moderation and it's got to fit within the grower's budget. We're not trying to burst the budget, but we're just saying that the more that they can do of that wave creating or riding the peaks of this microbial activity, the more they're going to see in soil fertility, long-term sustainability, soil health, and in the yield and the quality of the crop on the other end.
So this works extremely well for any irrigation that's going on, putting it in through the irrigation, drip, furrow, flood, sprinkler. What about the guy who's got who's farming on non-irrigated land?
Yeah, again, they're typically coming across with some kind of a spray. Either it's a pre-emergent herbicide or it's some other type of of a spray that they're doing either pre-plant or post-plant or even post-emergence, they're coming across with something. And so we just piggyback with whatever they're doing. And we're happy to do it that way. We do believe that one of the best ways, if you're spraying, if you can spray before hilling, then you're spraying and then you're hilling or hipping up into the hill, the concentration, a greater concentration of the zap material to create that environment within the hill. So yeah, good point. Certainly through any irrigation system, and the benefit of the more technical irrigation systems is that then the budgets for that particular crop go up per acre, per hectare. So you're able to increase those budgets and then maybe come back and, you know, certainly in the highest technical irrigation systems, drip irrigation, you can apply every 15 days and it's just not that big a deal to put a little dose in there every 15 days and just keep pushing those waves of microbial activity, if you will, to always outcompete or competitively exclude the negative microbial activity.
So Barrett, you're out there in the field quite a bit these days. Anything you want to add to this discussion before we move on to ProMax?
Yeah, speak of the devil, I'm actually out in the fields right now in Arkansas looking at some peanuts here. I kind of just echo what Lyndon was saying about how important the soil microbial community is and the importance for the root exudates to have a good area to live and to breathe and to really, you know, give a good working environment for those roots to flourish. Zap is a very novel product that does a lot of good things for the microbes. And in that regard, and also on top of what it's got, the ingredients that are in it, it'll help kind of release up nutrients, help with the buffering of pH for nutrients, through competitive exclusion, fight off diseases. It's just a great product that even in this area, in the row crop industry with cotton and corn and soybeans, that the prices are low, we can still come in and see a tremendous benefit for doing Zap. Mark Gregor out here in Arkansas is just having loads of fun with getting Zap in furrow and getting it in all throughout the growing season to really push and to keep everything up and running and fight off a lot of the diseases and reduce a lot of the pesticides that are applied because we're so healthy down below. So I love Zap and we're just excited to keep it going in the row crop industry as well as push it more in the vegetable and the fruit industry as well.
I appreciate what Barrett has said there because there are more benefits to Zap other than just stimulating microbial activity. It has the ability to flocculate clays. It has the ability to increase water holding capacity. It has the ability to release nutrients that are tied up in the soil solution and allow them to be more available to crops. And so it does many other things than just the microbial activity. Some would say it buffers salt, it takes care of toxicities, it does a lot of other things. Some could say, well, that's really through the beneficial microbial activity, and we will give that some of that. However, there's also some chemical reactions that are going on through the microcarbon technology in Zap that are changing the environment, the chemistry of the soil solution as well. I know that there's a lot of cut ground in that area. Can you tell us a little bit about some of the experiences that your growers are seeing there in the Mississippi Delta area, the greater Delta region, with cut ground and the application of Zap?
Sure. A couple different stories that have been fun over the past few years. Lyndon and I were out visiting a farmer and we had some Zap in the back of our truck and he says, hey, what's this Zap product that you have? And they had just started using our product, Breakout and some other things. And we drove up past him and he's like, hey, what is that? And I said, oh, this is that for, you know, getting the microbial community up and running and help fight off diseases. And he's like, well, how will it do on my cut ground? And then Lyndon says, well, let's go look at it. And so we went over and looked at it. And for years and years, they had, you know, for three, like it was probably 5 or 6 years ago, they had cut this ground and it was just struggle. They put NPK on it, you know, try everything they can to put out micronutrients, wouldn't go anywhere. We walk through the fields, and Lyndon loves doing this, and he'll tell you that. He bent down, picked up some soil, and rubbed it in his fingers and smelled it, and he looked at the farmer. He had him, hey, what do you smell? And the farmer said, I don't smell anything. He said, that's exactly right. Your soil is dead. Your soil is dirt, and we need to get this back to life, and ZAP's going to do that for you. So we did an application of ZAP, some superfos, and I think some calcium as well. And within that first year, easily brought it back, and had a reasonable crop that looked like a crop that he had planted normally, that struggled for years and years. And afterwards, the next couple of years afterwards, every single cut ground that they did, they always applied some ZAP to bring it back. And now they're doing ZAP over their healthy ground. I'm going to go look at some of those fields today. Another thing is, we were up at a distributor up in Jonesboro area, south of Jonesboro, and they had some cut ground, and the farmer was, or the retailer was suggesting to put out some chicken litter on that, and Mark Gregory said, hey, let's put some ZAP on top of that chicken litter, help turn that under, help break down that chicken litter, as well as get the microbes up and running, fight off the diseases that are in the chicken litter, et cetera. And he said that was the best decision he's ever done, was do the ZAP with the chicken litter on top of that. And like what you were saying, the ZAP with any other microbe inoculant, or ZAP with any other, you know, injection that they're doing to get the biology stimulated, ZAP's going to be the 1-2 punch that's really going to make the difference.
And if I could interject, the name ZAP, first time I heard that, it's like, ZAP, what are we killing? But it's not about killing, it's about zapping some life into the soil, right?
Exactly. Yeah, opposite of what it normally would be. You zap it with a chemistry, you're going to kill them. But you zap it with this product, you're going to really stimulate them. So I love that. I've teased before, if we're going to inoculate, or if we're going to put down some other type of microbial beneficial stimulant, manure, compost tea, whatever, the very best thing is to give them a sack lunch so that they can proliferate. And that's what ZAP becomes, as an excellent nutrient source, a carbon-rich material for causing that to happen. The other thing that you commented on there, Barrett, briefly, was how the ZAP changes the environment. So what we see in cut ground typically is a plant that comes up and it just has no root because it's in a hard pan. It's been cut and it creates a hard pan there. And so the roots can't penetrate. And then when you apply the ZAP and the roots just go down, it's quite fun. Any other stories there, Barrett?
Yeah, actually, we were just talking to a farmer this morning we pulled up one of his cotton roots and it went down, you know, 2 or 3 inches and then just blitzed off to the side, completely horizontal. And we've done that time after time out here. Mark's done a really good job of pushing that. We've got a couple issues with farmers over the years that have struggled with hard pan, and we'll do a heavier dose of ZAP in furrow, or, you know, broadcast, and water it in real good, make sure we got a good, you know, good application there. And within, if we've got severe issues, it might take us two shots. We'll do one gallon the first year, and maybe a half gallon or a quart the next year in furrow. And we're able to go out there and measure and pull up roots, and that root goes straight down and nice and thick and beautiful and lush and branches all up. So with hard pan especially, we can knock that out with an application or two of ZAP. Most of the time we can do it in 1 year with just a quart to a half gallon in furrow to help them save some money because they're tight budgeted out here. But we really see improvements of the soil and that hard pan really getting that loosed up, getting the microbes to spread out there and break that up a little bit better, and then give an extra stimulant to the root to really push through and make a big, big difference. So it's been a lot of fun what we've done with ZAP out here.
So people need to understand they've got a whole underground army that they can take advantage of if they help it along. You want to feed the soil, so you feed the microbes so they can do their jobs, so the plants can do their jobs.
There's some really cool instrumentation that's coming online, some of the new stuff that we're seeing that measures the beneficial microbial activity in the soil. And those are coming. They're not here fully yet, but there are some test kits that do some microbial activity testing in the field really quick, rather than having to send it to a lab and do a plate count and all that kind of thing. But I'll just tell you, the shortest cut I know is what Barrett brought up earlier, is to smell the soil. And there's four or five distinct smells that you get when you smell the soil. One is no smell at all, and that just means it's sterile and you're not getting any microbial activity. Another one is you smell chemical. And there's many times that I've smelled the chemical, and that's because they've used a fumigant and there's still chemical residue in the soil. Well, that's worse than the sterile one, because you've got to get rid of that toxicity before you can even get beneficial microbes to come back. So that's the worst one. Then the next one is you can actually smell soil that has that sulfur smell. And clearly it's from that anaerobic environment that's created in the soil root zone. And so if you smell that sulfur smell, you know that's not good. The one that you really want to smell is that very earthy smell that you can think of in your grandma's garden, or you can think of going out in a field after it's been disked and you smell that really beautiful earthy smell, lots of earthworms. That really wonderful smell is caused by what they call actinomycetes, which is one of the microbial organisms, not a microbe, but a higher life form than a microbe. But in that diversity, it's one of the very important ones. And that's what creates that very beneficial smell. So it's not microbial activity necessarily. It's the actinomycetes, or actinomycetes, however you want to say it, depending on what part of the country you're from. That's what really creates that beautiful aroma.
This concludes part one of a two-part podcast on soil biology and soil health with Lyndon and Barrett Smith. Be sure to listen to part two when we talk with Lyndon and Barrett about our OMRI-listed organic nematicide and fungicide, Promax. Keep following the Huma Gro Farmer podcast for the latest information on enhancing your crops using Huma Gro products. Grow healthy.